Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you so much for being here. We are just really excited to be having conversations with folks who are getting vaccinated and seeing this in action. You know, we have talked quite a bit leading up to this time about what these mobile vaccination units look like, and it's super exciting to see it. We're rocking our stickers today and just really I think are here in a commitment to each other and in a commitment to community. You know, there are folks here today who are receiving their second dose of the Moderna vaccine. And, you know, I think folks feel relieved. What people were telling me is that it's a way that, you know, they just take care of each other, a way to get some of these masks off and make sure that we can get back to normal. But my hope is also that we get back to better, because normal wasn't necessarily working for all of us before. But this is giving me a lot of hope, and I hope that it's giving you hope too. I know that the Asian Pacific Islander community has been hit pretty hard by COVID, and we know even just recently we lost a community member in Regent Her, and so this is so personal for so many of us. And as someone who lost a loved one very early on to COVID, this all feels very personal to me, and I know that it feels so personal to everyone who is here and who is working on getting the vaccine out. We know that folks have also been impacted, of course, by the virus, but also by the increased hate and discrimination against our Asian communities. And I know that Joe Biden literally just signed, I think I'm looking at to folks, right, literally just signed the Asian American anti-hate legislation. And so that is an exciting thing for us to lift up. We need to do more here, frankly, in Minnesota on that as well, but it is a really solid foundation on which to build. So to the community, I see you, I value you, I am grateful to be here, and just so appreciative of Hmongtown for using this space, for selling me some plants. I think that's gonna happen too. But you know, we're stronger together, and we certainly know that in this moment more than ever before. It's still really deeply emotional to watch people receive their vaccines. Every site I go to, I have a sort of a wave of just appreciation, but also just know the kind of peace of mind that I feel now being vaccinated, that my family feels, and we are eager to make sure that our 8-year-old daughter, right, is in line as soon as she's eligible for the vaccine as well. But the reason that we're here and we're here with this mobile unit is because we want to remove as many barriers as possible to ensure that people are getting vaccinated. And so bringing doses directly to community is one of the ways that we do that. In a place where you feel welcome, in a place where you feel comfortable, and we want to make this, again, as easy as possible. That's why the events here at Hmongtown and other events across the state have been so important to make sure that we are getting towards that goal of 70% of Minnesotans at least being vaccinated, and we are well on our way. And our mobile vaccine clinics have been really instrumental in doing that. There's been a lot of activity here in the Twin Cities, but as I've been talking to our folks from the vax team, also going out to greater Minnesota and doing this work as well, which really matters. And I want to lift up HAP. I want to lift up the Hmong American Partnership has been so important in this work, having those trusted organizations on the ground that are getting people to say, I have a relationship with HAP, and so I know that this is a trusted partner and getting vaccinated is a good thing for me to do. The United Cambodian Association of Minnesota too, we know that folks are here from the community as well because of that trusted partnership. And you know, I think we talk a lot about vaccine hesitancy. And I think, you know, Dr. Chamillo, who's been the head of our vaccine equity work, has actually started to talk about vaccine deliberation, that's one of the ways that we talk about this, making sure that people have as much information as possible to make this choice and to make this choice for themselves, for their family, and for their community. So there's no better way to do this than literally having community partners here on the ground. So we're super excited about it. And you know, we know that the folks who are receiving their second dose here are well on their way to being fully vaccinated and will have the full protection that these vaccines offer. And it is certainly a good day. So I am grateful to be in this space with you. I am grateful to Dr. Ling, who is volunteering his time today on the bus to get people vaccinated, and for all of you just being here. And And with that, one of our just really critical partners to this work, generally for the health of all Minnesotans, but also in ensuring the people of color and Indigenous folks have access to the vaccine and health equity in general, has been Blue Cross Blue Shield. So I wanted to introduce Vajang Mua with Blue Cross Blue Shield to come on up and to share a little bit with us about why we're here and how we got here too.
Thank you, Lieutenant Governor Flanagan, our community partners. It's been over a year since I've been in this place. This is a place where I go to get my sticky rice, my papaya salad. This is where I take my parents to reconnect with their friends and family. So this is a special place in my family and my people's heart. I want to begin by thanking all the state and community partners. For me, this represents a cross-sector, a cross-cultural connection and commitment to advancing racial and health equity. I want to also thank the United Cambodian Association of Minnesota, Hmong American Partnership, the 18 Clan Council, Anthony and you and your entire leadership team, MDH, Metro Transit, Met Council. If it sounds like a long list, that's by intention and by design. I really want everybody to understand the coordination and collaboration across sectors, across cultures, across disciplines, to making sure that we prioritize racial and health equity. The Hmong community and many other communities of color, Indigenous communities, have faced serious racial and health inequities in COVID and before COVID. And we've always known that racism has been a public health crisis, but it's been illuminated and exacerbated even more so since the pandemic. But I want to be clear that the challenges we face extend from epidemic to pandemic, from slow deaths in our communities to violent deaths in our streets. This is an effort, in my mind, that represents building racial and health equity into the design, into the purpose, into the values of how we engage with communities. I just want to call out that this mobile unit is addressing inequities in transportation, in ability, in language, in access, that is really addressing the barriers. But as Lieutenant Governor Flanagan mentioned, it is removing barriers and it's going beyond that. It is physically and metaphorically building bridges and going out into communities. And so I think it's important to recognize that the onus of getting vaccination isn't just on communities, but it's a shared accountability and a shared opportunity as well. My final remarks, I want to address the Hmong community and all communities that experience racial and health inequities. I just want to remind our people that we have crossed the Mekong River, that we have overcome refugee camps, that we have overcome and we are still fighting systemic racism in this country and before we even arrived in this country. And so I say this with true hope and optimism that we can overcome COVID-19. Okay. And I just want to remind our people of our ancestry, of our ancient ways of knowing and doing good, and so that we will overcome this crisis like we have many other crises. Thank you. I'm not sure who's next, but I'm going to pass it on to Twa. And thank you, Twa. Thank you, Twa, for providing your space, your place. Ocho nana, Twa.
So good morning, people. My name is Tua, the owner of Hmongtown Marketplace. 17 years ago, in 2004, I started this from an empty vacant lumber yard. On the fact that it is about 100,000 of us, the Hmong people here in the city of St. Paul in Minnesota. And the dream is to really build something, because a lot of the Hmong seniors who came because of the fact of us serving, our father serving the CIAs, we got here, a lot of us are missing our country so much, they do not have the mechanism to go back to Laos or Thailand. And here Hmongtown Marketplace offers that alternatives. You see the food, you see the color, you see the language, and you see the people, you see the friends. So this is not only a marketplace. We often joke around saying this is the Hmong Mall of America. this is what we joke, because we have over 200 vendors, and we have the farmers market. So in terms of employment, it is about 600 people being employed, including the children, the young college. So Hmongtown Marketplace is also an incubator incubating some small business. And who knows, a lumberyard self-funding from day one until today, who knows, it's going to be a vibrant marketplace that offers a lot of opportunities for a lot of people. So thank you for coming here. And what is so sad to me is that the COVID-19 had made the Hmongtown Marketplace faces a lot of difficulties. Shops have to be shut down for a long time. Food only being ordered to go out, and food traffic is difficult. Vendors are leaving, and mama papa shops cannot sustain themselves. PPP loan comes, those mama papa shops do not have the mechanism to apply online to get any money. So we're facing the whole spectrum of difficulties. What's more important, what's more saddened to me is that just the month of November and December alone, just past November and December, I have lost a lot of friends who are at my age. We, our parents who brought us here because of the CIA services had come and gone, they brought us here, that's gone, that's good. People like us who came here worked really hard under public assistance, and we went to college, and we now got ourselves sustained, and we're about to go out and enjoy America, traveling to states, and now we died because of COVID-19. We lost a lot of friends, and it is so sad. Therefore, we Hmongtown Marketplace is so appreciating of donating this parking lot so that we can have vaccines, and we would like to come back to the old normal. Like Lieutenant Governor said earlier, the old normal is not good enough. We have to go beyond that. And I am hoping that we will be going beyond that very, very, very soon. So thank you so much for coming here, and we will be hosting it again as much as we can. Thank you so much.
I'm sorry. Okay. Well, thank you so much, everyone, for being here, and again, reminding us where we come from. And I think about that too. As a Ojibwe woman, we've been through pandemics before, right? We've been through difficulties before, and yet we are still here. And so I stand with you, and look forward to getting to the other side. But as Tua mentioned, we've got a lot of work to do. And we wanna also, of course, honor just the memory and legacy of the people that we've lost by continuing to try to improve our communities and opportunities for folks. And I know that through the Department of Health and through these partnerships, we've learned quite a bit about how to better serve our communities, to bring health to them, to work through telehealth and other pieces. So I hope that some of the positive things that can come out of this really dark time is that we do a better job of serving our communities and serving our BIPOC communities as well. So with that, I'm happy to take a couple questions. I'll take comments or snide remarks too, though, they're fine. There are six buses so far. We have 62 community events that are happening this week, some with the buses, some without, and there'll be, I think, 135 events that are scheduled just over the coming weeks alone.
A question for
Yeah.
Yes. How important is it to bring it right here, where it can kind of spread by word of mouth? people can go shopping, come right in line, but really using this as a community resource to spread the word and tell other people, like, oh, I'm going to go get my shot, and trying to get more people to come get in line.
This is very, very important. If we are let known ahead of time, we'll advertise, and we should advertise, and we should go to some sort of Hmong media, so and so, something like that. As soon as you say vaccination is happening at Hmongtown marketplace, everybody knows where it is.
Right.
So it's really hard, it's really easy to come. And when they come here, they're thinking, saying, it's a one-stop trip. They come here, they get the vaccine, they come here, they also shop, they also see friends. So we will be pleased to do that again, and let us know ahead of time so we can advertise, and we'll do that until we feel like we are feeling that we need to take this one out. Let's do that again.
That's right. Come on back to the Hmong Mall of America.
Yeah.
That's right. Okay. Yeah.
Can you talk a little bit about the vaccination for the 12 to 15-year-olds?
Sure. So right now, and we were just in an event yesterday, trying to encourage 12 to 15-year-olds to get vaccinated. I saw quite a few young people who were there. So right now, our young people in Minnesota are eligible for the Pfizer vaccine if they are 12 years of age and older. That's a 2-dose vaccine, and folks can go to the vaccine connector and learn more about where they can get their shot. It's time, and I think our young people get it. As I've said over and over again, you know, my daughter is ready to get vaccinated. She's 8, which is, you know, we've come a long way because she doesn't like shots a lot, but she's excited about this one. And I think it really is just testament that our young people understand. They understand how we can take care of each other, getting back to the things that we love, hanging out with friends, bike rides, going to grandma's house, I think pediatricians are going to be really important as part of that, just making parents feel comfortable, continuing to work with community organizations to encourage our young people to get vaccinated as a way to protect themselves, but also to protect our elders and our other family members. But I'm hopeful. It seems like, you know, I think, Chris, do you know how many young people have signed up so far? Do you remember the number?
13.3% of 12 to 15 year olds
13.3% of all 12 to 15-year-olds have already been vaccinated. That's amazing, and that number is only going to increase.
So, what is the timeline for this?
So they're still in the vaccine trials for that, and I don't know, Chris, if you want to speak to that, Chris Ayersman from the Department of Health on the timeline.
Right now, we are aware that, you know, Pfizer is the first manufacturer to have a vaccine for the full adolescent spectrum. But both Moderna and Johnson & Johnson, Moderna is in clinical trials for adolescents, and Johnson & Johnson plans to start them. When it comes to children, Pfizer is already doing those clinical trials. And we had been saying that we expected in 2022 there would be vaccine. Now, Pfizer thinks it could be as early as this fall, so that is incredibly encouraging. And then Moderna and Johnson & Johnson are both in the process of Moderna starting clinical trials in that population, and Johnson & Johnson will be. So there will be more vaccines coming, but Pfizer's on track, it sounds like, for this fall, which, like I said, is really encouraging.